So far you've seen how to use vector instructions to attain high performance by properly utilizing the vector registers. And as a result, you got very good performance for small matrices. And what you kind of noticed was that you did very well for small matrices, then okay for a little bit bigger matrices, and then eventually it got really bad. And what we're going to find out next is that in order to attain good performance across the board, you're going to have to effectively take advantage of the memory hierarchy of a modern CPU. Now, the problem is that we could go and teach you an entire course on computer architecture, and then at the end of 12 weeks or 15 weeks, you would understand absolutely everything. Or we could just give you a high-level understanding of what the basic principles are that affect high performance and get on with it. So, we're going to just keep things simple and we'll get on with it. And you'll be surprised about how well you can do if you simply apply those basic principles. So what's going on? Well, we've seen so far that a computer architecture has registers. Data has to be moved into the registers if you are to compute with it. And we've alluded at the fact that there is main memory where data generally is stored. Now, the problem is that main memory is really, really slow. How slow? Two orders of magnitude slower than it takes to do a floating point operation. Maybe even more. What's even worse is that that ratio gets worse every year. Processor speeds improve much faster than the speed of memory. So, once your problem has to be stored in main memory because it's very large, you inherently are paying the price of moving data between the memory and the registers. In order to overcome this bottleneck, back in the 1980s, people came up with the idea of having a small amount of very fast memory much closer to the registers, much closer to the CPU. As a matter of fact, it would be on chip. So what does that mean? Well, there's some small layer of memory that is fast, much faster than main memory, slower than registers, and that was called the cache. Or cache memory. Why? Because you cache data there, you try to do lots of computations with it before you move it back out. That's the basic idea. All right, well, the cache worked pretty well until things got worse. And then they said, instead of having one cache, let's have two caches. So at that point, we ended up with a level one cache. And they created something called the level 2 cache. All right, and essentially what happens is the L1 cache is small, the L2 cache is bigger, and as a result, you can bring a bigger chunk of data into the L2 cache. Hopefully, bigger means that you do much more computation with that data, and therefore, you can overcome that bottleneck that the main memory has become. What's better than two caches? Three caches. So these days, modern architectures have three levels of cache. Even more relatively fast memory. What's better than three caches? Four caches. And now starting to come out with architectures that have four levels of cache. Anyway, the trick is going to be how to move data into the various caches and to then do lots of computation with it before you have to write it back out to another layer of cache or main memory or wherever it needs to end up.